Well, let's start. Good morning, everybody. I'm Bader Benjloun. It's my pleasure to meet you again in this new conference by the INRA webinar series dedicated to discuss trends and innovations in agriculture. I would like to welcome all the participants from different countries, probably, for taking the time to attend this webinar. And probably also to enrich this session by their questions and comments. Then I would like to thank warmly our guest speaker, Dr. Alessandra Stella from the National Research Council in Italy, for accepting our invitation to share her deep experience with us. I will have the pleasure to introduce Dr. Alessandra myself. I know Dr. Alessandra for more than 10 years. We meet indeed in the first time during the kickoff of the Next Gen project, which is a new FP7 project in 2010. Since that time, we've had great collaborations within three different European projects, and also in the International Goat Genome Consortium that Alessandra co-chair. So Alessandra Stella is a senior scientist at the National Research Council in Italy, and also lead scientific advisor of the Milan Innovation District. She graduated from the University of Milan in Italy, and then from the University of Guelph in Canada, where she got her master and also PhD degrees. She has almost 30 years experience in genetics, genomics, and bioinformatics applied to livestock, plant, and humans. Her main interests are the understanding of the genetic effects on complex traits and the study of genetic diversity. She collaborated with breeder associations and agri-food industry in Italy, Germany, in the US, and Canada. She has participated in more than 20 EU-funded projects. She published more than 130 peer-reviewed papers, and she is currently based in Milan. Today, she's going to talk about the analysis and role of epigenetics in livestock breeding. Before giving the floor to you, Dr. Alessandra, I would like to mention that the conference will take up to 40 minutes, and then we will have the discussion that will take up to 40 minutes. We will end the webinar by 11:30. Because Alessandra has another commitment in another location also. She has to travel later. For the discussion, please post your written questions via the chat on Zoom. Please fill in your name and affiliation before the question, and do not wait until the end of the conference to ask them. You can post your questions in English or French as well. You can also ask your questions orally. Please raise your electronic hand, and my colleague Boutaina will give you the floor. So we look forward to listening to you, Dr. Alessandra, and to knowing more about this exciting topic. Thank you.
And thank you very much, Dr. Benjaloo.
Can you activate your mic, please? Okay.
Okay, it's activated. Can you hear me? Okay. Yes, perfect. Thank you very much, Badra. And I will now share my screen.
Perfect.
There we go. And here, the reason I chose this picture is because it really reminds me a lot of when I traveled for the Next Gen project to Morocco. And I was quite astonished by the fact that you have such a variety of landscapes in Northern Africa, ranging from very fertile flats to mountains, rocky mountains like the Atlas. And this is a picture taken on the Dolomites, which is the Alps northeast of Italy. And this, you know, we have kind of the same variety of different environments, which take us a little bit on the presentation today on the analysis and the role of epigenetic in livestock breeding. Okay, so epigenetics, we go back a little bit to the definition, and epigenetic has been defined by Berger and al. As the set of marks on the genome that induce changes in gene expression without, of course, altering the DNA sequence in the cell. And of course, epigenetics has been known for a few decades now, but just now, of course, with the improvement in sequencing and in general in genomic analysis has become easier to investigate the single processes of epigenetics. And this modification can be stable and heritable during mitosis. So the information is passed through by regulating gene expression while the cells divide. And when we talk about, so this is the definition of epigenetics. When we talk about the epigenome of a specific cell, we refer to a complete set of epigenetic marks. So methylation is one, and we will see a little bit about that. Post-translational histone changes, modification, chromatin remodeling, also following methylation, of course, and a wide range of non-coding RNAs and other molecules which modulate the expression of the DNA sequence. So epigenetics, here the mom says, you can be anything you want when you grow up to a stem cell. Of course, all the cells of an individual possess the same DNA sequence or genetic heritage, but of course develop into very many different functions by regulating gene expression depending on the physiological stage and the cell type. And these epigenetic marks are reversible and depending on the environment, but can also have, of course, long-term consequence on the individual. And here I try to summarize the complexity of the phenotypes that we observe. They are given, of course, and we, you know, in animal breeding know that very well, from the specific DNA sequence on which, of course, we have worked successfully for many years in selection. First of all, starting from phenotypic selection and then genetic selection and genomic selection, especially, you know, in cattle and small ruminants and pigs, we had amazing advances. And how these changes in the DNA sequence are given by, of course, random changes occurring to the DNA, you know, base changes, so single polymorphism, as well as deletion, translocation, and different genomic changes. There are, of course, pushed by natural and artificial selection, given by the environmental factors, including, of course, selection for more production, to stabilize random mutation in DNA in the process of genetic variation. But of course, to get to the phenotypes, we also have a important influence of environmental effect. In livestock, of course, this influence can be direct, given by the management and so on, but it is largely mediated through epigenetics, where epigenetic changes given by feed, for example, quality of feed, the in utero environment, and of course the environment, possible stress and biotic stress, have an influence on the epigenetic, on the epigenome in general, and as well as the biological factor like the sex, the physiological stage, age, influence the expression of the genome itself, resulting in many different phenotypes. And this process is definitely mediated by all the epigenetic changes that we are reviewing today. And one of the, like, let's say the one of the major epigenetic mark is methylation. So within the DNA sequence, the cytosine residual of the CpG denucleotides, so cytosine, phosphate, guanine, can be methylated to 5-methylcytosine. On average, on the genome, about 10% of the cytosine are methylated in mammals. Although this percent, of course, can change very much depending on the region. In fact, regions with the highest density of GPG sites are called CpG islands. And this region are evolutionary sign of important regulation regions. In fact, these regions are mostly methylated when they are associated with the repetitive elements in the genome, such as the retrotransposon, which are interesting, very interesting mobile elements, which through evolution, they have been incorporated and accumulated in mammal's genome, but they are of viral origins. And of course, to keep stability in the cell, we want to prevent their replications and protect the rest of the genome from their invasion. And again, in the centromeric and pericentromeric region, and this is another way of controlling to limit the undesirable chromosomal recombination and segregation. So the activities of methylation are mainly inhibition of gene expression associated with regulatory, when they are associated or located close to regulatory elements and promoters. And again, as a role of control in limiting the initiation of what we would call illegitimate transcription. So when we don't want the transcription to happen, and this is mainly when they are located in intragenic regions. And then they play a role in X chromosome inactivation, which is on one hand, limiting the burden of having the two copy of the X chromosome in female, and also play the important role in the genomic imprinting, where one of the gene inherited from one of the parents is activated and the other one is suppressed. So here methylation plays a major role. And the different epigenetic marks, particularly at the level of these CpG islands upstream of the transcription initiation site, cause chromatin instruction to be more or less open. And this process, we have to remember, is reversible. right, is reversible and is mediated by a number. Now here I synthesize just few of them of family of enzyme, which are antagonistic activities. So you see some for methylation, some for histone methylation, and some for histone acetylation. And in particular, DNA methyltransferases are particular importance. And here you see they are, I can go back, yes. The two major classes, one is the methyltransferase 3A and 3B, which are involved mainly in the de novo methylation, while for replication is guided mainly by DNMT1. Histone modification, what happened to histones? They have a N-terminal tail that are targeted by different type of modification. And here is very many, acetylation, phosphorylation, they become isomers and so on. And of course, in this way, they apply regulation of the accessibility of the genomic DNA to transcription. So in general, when we see, as a general rule, when we see acetylation, we will have a production of euchromatin, which of course implies more transcription, you know, allow transcription, and deacetylation will have the formation of heterochromatin with less transcription. And and really, although there are like a wide range of activity, and depending also on the site of, for example, methylation, as well as acetylation, I have to say. Just a note that we will see then later in sperm cells. Sperm cells, of course, they have, you know, the epigenetic things. Sperm cell, we will see later, plays a very, very relevant role. And in livestock species, you know, they've been investigated quite well, including what we will see later from CNR and my group. We have to note that histones are replaced in the sperm cell by protamine. Of course, they have a very important role in chromatin compaction, which, you know, is quite important for the quality of the sperm cell and, of course, the role in reproduction. And then we get to another major player in epigenetic control, which are non-coding RNA. So now if we consider that only 1 or 2% of the genome has a protein coding potential, you know, of course, it was obvious to ask, why do we have so much a genome? And I have to say, you know, most of the transcript, even if they do not code from proteins, still transcription play a big role. And non-coding RNA have shown in the last, I would say, 20 years, you know, of different studies and publication, an amazing role in a large variety of biological function. If you review literature of cancer development, you know, you will find tons of publication on non-coding RNA, on microRNA, all the different classes of non-coding RNA. And as well, you know, in the livestock and production, and pretty much wherever there is a complex regulation of expression. And again, you know, of course, regulation of expression, but this we will see, not only non-coding RNA are classified here, first of all, you know, very roughly based on their size, over 200 nucleotides, long non-coding RNA, and lower than 200 short non-coding RNA, but very much relevant on their functions. So for protein synthesis, chromosome X inactivation, again, as we described before, also involving control of the burden of the X, of the double X, involving epigene modification, post-transcriptional processing, and modulation of chromatin, gene regulation, again, in many different purposes as well, you know, in the immune system, defense against viruses and transposon activities, which of course, you know, are involving directly our DNA sequence. So again, as a factor of protection, and of course, they are involving the orientation of heterochromatin and the methylation of other RNAs. This is very important again. So there's no RNA in the spliceosome complex and in the regulation of transposon activity, again, as we said for methylation. And as you will see, the location on genome varies a little bit from species to species, from tissue to tissue, as we will see. So they can occur in clusters and intronic regions and so on. And how does it work with the Mirna cascade? How do they work? And here we have a little bit of a summary of the formation of the RISC, the RNA induced silencing cascade, which, you know, is schematically what happened when microRNA works, and is involving different steps. First of all, the transcription of the Mirna encoding gene into what is called primary mRNA in the nucleus, of course, maturation of the primary microRNA into a precursor, again at the nuclear level, and then outside in the, taken outside in the cytoplasm, the preliminary preliminary microRNA is moved from the nucleus to the cytoplasm, and it goes through a process of maturation into mature mRNA and the formation of what is called this RISC complex. What does this RISC complex do then? It's guided to the target, because microRNA targets. And here is very much a multi-univoc process, since different microRNAs may have different targets, and each mRNA can be targeted as well by several doses. Each mRNA can be targeted by several microRNA RISC complex. So this implies, you know, multiple level of regulation, as generally the RISC complex guided to mRNA can induce the inhibition of translation or the degradation of a messenger RNAs. Oh, and here is just to show you from a work from Joanna Sita, guided from Joanna Sita, how the distribution of long coding RNA, for example, in different species of livestock changes in percentage in the different region, with again like usually a quite a high representation in the intronic region, but I found, like, you know, quite interesting that there is quite a variability there, which I think, you know, is interesting first to picture, you know, so the importance to have a picture for each species, which since is very characteristics like that. And then analyze on also on an evolutionary standpoint. And here I put a few slides here to describe my organization and to get to guide you into how we got to work with epigenetics. So, sorry, here it goes by itself. Institute of Biology and Biotechnology, Agriculture, Biology and Biotechnology is part of the National Research Council of Italy. National Research Council is a very large multidisciplinary organization in Italy. It's actually the largest public research institution with, you know, now almost 9,000 employees of staff, mainly, of course, researchers, and we have location pretty much all across the country. And as, again, being multidisciplinary, we have a lot of interaction with research and from the different fields, which, you know, I think is our richness there. The mission of my institute is the understanding of molecular bases of the biological system that are important in agriculture. Here, you know, in case you come and visit us, we have four different locations in Milan and Lodi, so in northern Italy, in Pisa, which is in Tuscany, and Rome. And we, the institute is comprised now, starting last month, of 45 researchers, and just in the last year we had about 63 papers on the important recognized journal, scientific journal, and we currently have about 24 projects running. So the Milan and Lodi unit, here are like our focus, which is very relevant to this presentation, but it's not exclusive, of course, is the characterization and conservation of genetic diversity in livestock and plants. As you see, if you review our publication, we are applying molecular genetics and bioinformatic methods to species across the two kingdoms, right? We work with livestock as well as with crops, and we use, of course, omics technologies, and also, you know, we work in taking it down to the field to breeder association and so on by developing breeding schemes. So introducing the findings of our research into actual application into improving livestock production. And we have a specific session, which is very relevant on what we will be talking about today, on reproduction and cryopreservation of germplasm for small ruminant cattle and pigs. And again, the group that I coordinated, it works in biostatistics and bioinformatics, you know, with about 25 years experience, developing new tools and software that are tailored for these emerging omics technologies. And I have to say that epigenetic kept us very busy because nothing was obvious there. We had to do a lot of developing. And I just want to highlight that we hold in Lodi, with a copy in the University of Milan, the most important gene bank. And here you see the representation of the different breeds. We are harvesting more than 35,000 doses of Italian local breeds. So it's very good material for us to work also with reproduction. And here is how we got to work with epigenetic, really. You know, given our experience in reproduction, in the evaluation of semen quality and of oocyte quality, and the work on the efficiency of reproduction, and our experience with diversity of adaptation, defining really what are both the genomic and epigenetic then factors that define the ability to adapt to different environments and to different stressor, both biotic and abiotic stressor. You know, we decided to put all these expertise together, and we were developing a large nationally funded project called Genome Home. And at the same time, you know, we were working at different EU projects with goat. And I have to say, I'm biased here, but this is my favorite species. You know, I always found very fascinating their ability to adapt to many different environments. And sheep, of course, and cattle and buffalo, and as you will see, a little bit of on horses as well. So at that point, we were thinking, you know, one of the aspects, which is true for buffalo production, you know, our main product is mozzarella, and if you think it's mainly eaten in the summer, so there is a problem there with the seasonality of the animal. But it's the same, you know, for small ruminants. We got very interested in the regulation of reproduction and the seasonality. And that brought us to think, okay, what is there that, you know, has been accumulated in the evolution, and what is there that is regulated with the environment in the hypothalamus gonads axis that controls both, you know, the puberty, of course, but also these seasonality of fertility, right? It was for us a very interesting question, a physiological question, because of course, I mean, there are examples of animals that are then brought to environment where there is no seasonality, you know, at the equator or so, or seasonality is different and it's more dependent on the availability of pasture. And here we see some changes in some animals, some changes in, not changes in other. And we really, you know, focus on the fact that there must be an epigenetic control that could be reversible. And of course, we leave overall marks into the genomics, into the DNA, by really changing the reproduction behavior of these species. And of course, we had available techniques of next generation sequencing that, as I said before, really provide an amazing technical tools, and they are becoming cheaper and cheaper. We do not sequence in-house anymore, but you know, we have availability of services at prices that were unimaginable just, you know, 10 years ago when we started NextGen, for example. And so we started this adventure on the analysis of epigenetics. How it went, here we have a bunch of the progression of our studies for non-coding RNA, and that was the very first paper, I think it was published on Mirna in plants, I think it was about 7-8 years ago. And we started with the classification on non-coding RNA in RNA pools, and then we were looking at differential expression of more RNA classes, specific classes in the different tissue and organs, and also experimental condition. But again, like what we found, that of course in some of the species, especially the most neglected one, like goats, there was really a first step of importance was, first we have to map and see how the difference are with the other species and within species from the different tissues. And then we went on correlation expression analysis with expression of target genes, or specific target genes, and differential expression in different tissues and organs, you know, based on the epigenetic modification. Mirna profiling we use as a marker tool to discriminate between non-condition. So again, by comparing to different position, I will see later in the presentation. And study in effect, very recently here, the study of the effect of the Mirna cargo in what they're called extracellular vesicles in different condition. This is actually ongoing. We're preparing a paper right now. A previous paper was published by Emanuele Capra, and it could open another very interesting opportunity in the study of reproduction. And then we went on with the study of methylation. Again, studying of genomic imprinting. That started again many years ago. It was very interesting to investigated in pigs, but basically in every species we see many traits that follow this pattern of inheritance. And determination of, again, atlas, again, even there for methylation, we needed to have a reference for where methylation is, what percentage, where in the gene, for the species that we're dealing with. And again, you know, where they mapping, where they are located within the different gene regions, so genomic region, intergenic region, in exon, in introns, and so on. And as we see, both for non-coding RNA and for methylation, this is different for each species. So we needed to start from the basis there. Identification of correlation between the methylation status and gene expression. This has implied, as you would see, doubling the effort of sequencing with RNA sequence and sequence looking at methylation, and we will see how that is performed. Identification of differentially methylated region across different experimental conditions. And this again, you know, brought us to, was guided by this idea of the seasonalities, and see, well, what is, you know, that, why don't we force the different condition and compare how the methylation status change? And this brought us to identification of genes and metabolic pathways that are involved in the response to the specific environmental challenge, which in one case can be, you know, changes of the exposure to light for seasonality and, for example, exposure to extreme climate, as you will see with an experiment with the hot season. Individuation of the genomic region that are under evolutionary pressure. This again links back to our work with diversity, and these are driven by the hypermutation in region in the CPG island that are heavily methylated by the analysis of the epigenetic marks and their methylation status. And again, the study of the role of methylation in maintaining the chromosome structure and the possible effect on the, let's say, complex disorders. But in this case, we focus on male infertility, since UC has been proven to be a very direct effect. But of course, this can then be brought more generally to other and more complex disease conditions. We'll ask you just a second. I'll drink a little bit of water. Sorry about that. Okay, now, I have to say that what seemed, you know, like already well documented in the protocols for detection and identification of methylated residues, proved to, for us, at least for us, to be very cumbersome in the actual work, both in the lab and in the data analysis. And this is probably because most of the protocols were developed for humans, and we needed to adapt everything to our species and our genomes. So for detection of these methylated residues requires the use of bisulfite treatment of DNA. What does that do? This converts the unmethylated cytosine residue to uracil, while the methylated ones remains like that, are unaffected, remains as a cytosine. This treatment is then followed by, if you want to do whole genome sequencing, by bisulfite sequencing. So bisulfite sequencing is the use of the first step, so the bisulfite treatment, to determine the pattern of methylation. And then you sequence everything. And then there are like a partial genome sequencing, where, for example, like reduced representation bisulfite sequencing that combines some restriction enzyme and the bisulfite sequencing to performing an enrichment of the areas with the higher percentage of CpG content. And then, as you see, we also apply in two cases the methyl CpG binding domain protein sequencing, proteins of the MBD domain family are primary candidates for the readout of the DNA methylation because they recruit the chromatin remodelers and also some of the histone modification marks that we have seen, enzyme that we've seen before. And they're associated with gene repression. So we both applied this sometime even on the in the same study, both techniques. And here is just to acknowledge all our collaborators in the different papers that we have published over the last 5 years in methylation and non-coding RNA. And we'll get to some of these studies and now, and more recently on microvesicles. Okay, we get now to some of the specific studies. Check the time. Okay, the specific studies. Here, like first investigation is on the distribution of non-coding RNA expression across that hypothalamic pituitary gonadal axis that I described before. And this, you know, is one of these work where I said, you know, that we started with the mapping, with seeing what's there in this case, particularly in Capra hircus, in domestic goat. As you know, this goat estrous cycle is really accompanied by hormonal changes through puberty to sexual maturity. The coordination of the peripheral organs with the central nervous system ensure that the animal physiology is aligned with the external environment, which you know comes into work here to optimize the reproductive success. And of course, these you know the different the photo period, the light period is like a major player, major environmental player. The goat estrus is accompanied by hormonal changes along these hypothalamic pituitary gonadal axis, which orchestrate the morphological and physiological changes in the ovaries, which lead to ovulation and preparation of the oocyte maturation, sperm transport, fertilization, and all this process. And we know that the role of Myrna in modulating this axis is very important, very relevant. This is well was already well documented in humans. So what we do with it, we sample the hypothalamus and pituitary and ovaries from three goats, and non-coding RNA were sequenced. Now, we use for the analysis of the sequence different process for the actual microRNA detection and discovery is MIRDIP2 that identify microRNA and discover along the the genome also putative novel microRNA, because of course you know we worked both with orthologs and with homology with other well-known Myrna, but of course we wanted to discover new ones as well. And then we use the Ingenuity pathway analysis when we target the area for gene prediction. And again, we use this very handy software called CLUE-GO for gene ontology classification. In the lab, Myrna validation was performed by real-time PCR, and we also operated a comparison among the different organs and tissues, and we calculated and screened these differences using HR. Build process and protocols on GitHub that are available whenever you would want to access our work and use our routines. And here are some of the results. Here we have the distribution of different non-coding RNA classes. You see all here the different classes in function of the nucleotide length and GC content percentage. And again, here we clustered using normalized Myrna count for the three replicates. Of course, we had three replicates, I forgot to say, for each tissue since we had three animals in the three organs. And you see how well they cluster here, indicating the quite interesting differences on the three different tissues. So in the end, what happened here, we identify more than 400 Myrna that were already known, and 222 having homology with non-Myrna from other species. But we also identify 161 candidate novel Myrna that were predicted using our pipeline. When we look at genontology and pathway, we found out that many of the MIRNAT target genes were involved with fibroblast growth factor and epidermal growth factor response to the pituitary gland. You always have to remember that, of course, genontology terms, you know, may be biased towards some process. Regulation of the macromolecular metabolic process, organ development, cellular and developmental process were targeted by the MIRNA found upregulated in the hypothalamus and ovary. Other non-coding RNA were assigned to known classes by using homology. And the expression level of non-coding RNA classes among different organs, we use more than 1,500 non-coding RNA expressed in the three organs. And this revealed more than 8,094 non-coding RNA that were expressed between pituitary, eight, 147 and 94 between the pituitary and the hypothalamus and the ovary, and the pituitary and the ovary. So that gave us a nice general picture. And then again, we went on with the same tissue on the same species with the study of the methylome. And this was for us a satisfaction, because this was actually the first study on the goat methylome. And again, it was, you know, like mapping, reviewing three of the very important tissues in goat production, in general, in reproduction. And we have always to remember that in livestock, reproduction is really the main and most important process. So here we analyze the DNA methylation pattern at the level of hypothalamus and ovary from three adult sunning goats. And material was basically the same as the previous studies. And we used the approach, you know, of reduced targeted sequencing, but using the genome-wide map methylation, using this methyl CpG binding domain sequencing that is summarized here with genomic DNA fragments that are produced and then captured in this methyl CpG process. And genome-wide analysis showed that the majority of methylation peaks are found within genes, are located in the body of the genome. You see here the distribution is in hypothalamus and ovary, where you see mainly the most of the distribution in introns. As if you remember, non-coding RNA by the work of Joanna Sita was showing a little bit of the same in other livestock species. And approximately 50% of the CpG islands were methylated in hypothalamus and ovary. And X chromosome has a high percentage of methylated CpG islands in both organs. And here you see, again, the distribution across the chromosomes for the total GPG island, the methylated in the hypothalamus in blue and methylated in the ovary in red. The comparison between, okay, here we operate also, I forgot to say, a comparison between the transcriptome and the methylome in the two organs. And this is an interesting conclusion because it shows that a higher level of methylation in the two organs is not accompanied by a higher level of gene suppression. So the regulation, as I said, is much of a fine tuning. So it's not really a matter of, it's not quantitative. So that, you know, brings us to say that the average overall amount of methylation may not be as significant as really going into looking at the fine tuning, the specific regulation at gene level and the relative transcriptome. And again, like as I said, like we had both the capability and the expertise. My colleague Flavia Pizzi has been working in semen quality for more than 30 years now, and she's really an expert in all the characteristics that make semen more or less fertile. So here we run again a epigenetic analysis looking at methylation into classes of sperm population, high and low, with high and low mobility. And and we explore the CpG methylation in these two different sperm population. They were separated by this technique called Pergol, which I personally don't understand, has been explained to me a few times. And then we investigated by using bisulfite sequencing, whole genome bisulfite sequencing. We use for Italian bulls, for Holstein bulls. We use frozen semen and the isolation of sperm, and an evaluation of sperm mobility was done using this highly high-tech cell sorter. And again, like we use this Pergol, how can I say, like protocols, Pergol protocol to separate 45% and 50% the mobility of the two classes, so separate the population. And then we perform DNA extraction, library preparation and sequencing. And here I list a little bit what we use, nucleospin tissue for extraction, the methyl minor methylated enrichment kit for enrichment of methylated DNA. Preparation of a library for sequencing was performed with using TruSeq, and then we converted the methylated region, as I said, the methylated cytosine. We epitect bisulfite kits, and we amplified using PCR with this Kappa Uracil Plus to obtain this enriched bisulfite library. And then we perform Illumina sequencing on HiSeq 2000 at that time. And here is where I come into play more, the statistical analysis and bioinformatics. The first preliminary work on sequencing was performed with Trinomatic, And then we apply the Bismarck software. And again, HR for identification of different differential methylation. And we use again Qrego for definition of gene ontology. And what do we have here? Main results, age and low sperm population show a substantial variation in methylation of the telomerase reverse transcriptase, this TERT, and telomerase associated protein 1 TEPT, which you know, are well known they were previously reported. They're well known to have an effect on the on male infertility. And differential methylation at the 3' also found in gene, was also found in gene influencing the chromatin structure. So again, you know, we know that how telomeres are very important in the quality of the sperm cell, and the preservation of the telomere is very important. And we also find, and it's quite obvious that the chromatin structure for the fertility plays a very important role. So we have confirmation here of two processes that were well known. CBG Island really were very highly remodeled. An high proportion of these islands were was found to be methylated at low intermediate level and associated with this repetitive element BTSAT for satellites. The low intermediate level methylation was stably maintained in the pericentric region of the chromosome. And again, what else? BT, it was hypermethylated. Oops, sorry. No, sorry about that. I went a little bit ahead. In the again, like I want to highlight the importance of this repetitive element, which is hypomethylated in this population. So here is another study that really is looking at to how DNA methylation can serve as a marker for adaptation and response to stress. Here we study genome-wide DNA methylation in blood sample. So here we use blood because, you know, if you want to look for markers, you also have to find something that is easily accessible. So we use 5 bulls from two different breeds, which are actually one is an indicus and one is a tyrus breed in cattle. So 5 bulls from the Nelore breed, which has been known to be really resilient into harsh environmental condition, and 5 bulls from the instead very stress susceptible Angus breed, particularly in hot condition. And we apply a protocol that is synthesized here to expose the two breeds to a specific stress. And of course, you know, with everything that is related to the heat stress that, you know, is quite detrimental both on health and productivity. We investigated genome-wide DNA methylation in this blood sample, and the methylone were analyzed during and after the exposure of this stressful condition, and we use reduced representation B-SOVI sequencing, which of course provided a single-based resolution methylation profiles. And again, you see the process for analysis, which involve again the Bismarck software, as well as Bowtie and Picker tool, and the methyl kit for the analysis of the methylation site. Significant methylation changes between stressful and so the stressful period and the recovery periods were observed in more than 800 genes. Of these, 351 were exclusively in Angus, and 366 were specific to Nelore. 102 show significant changes in the methylation pattern in both breeds. The CAG for pathway analysis and gene ontology enrichment analysis show that responses were breed specific. And interesting, in Nelore, significant genes and pathways were mainly involved in the stress response and the cellular defense were undermethylated during the stress, the heat stress. Whereas in Angus, the response was more general, less specific, less focused. These preliminary result really suggests that heat challenge induces changes in methylation patterns in specific loci, and should really be better studies to assess their role in the heat tolerance. And here we go again, like, of course, you know, if you think back of the major historical studies on, particularly on methylation, epigenetic effect in general, methylation, were the ones performed on humans where food privation during the war, during famines, affected the pregnant women, and with a strong effect on the fetuses and on the progeny, really resulting from methylation and demethylation processes during pregnancy. So we really were very interested, again, first of all, in mapping the sheep fetuses in general. We found sheep in collaboration with Lino Loi, Professor Loi from the University of Teramo, which is a very important expertise in the production of in vitro production of fetuses. And we were first to map these three gem layers, and then try to understand how the implication of nutrition and environmental condition during pregnancy on the performance and on the viability of the progeny relevant with in correlation with the methylation status. So here we perform a study on the CBG methylation profiling of the mesodermal, ectodermal, endodermal tissue from these fetuses. And this gave us a very nice basis to further work on with maternal and the study, as I was saying, imposing maternal periconceptual, so very early in the pregnancy, under nourishment, and to see how this perturbs the methylome of the offspring. So here we want to evaluate if modification of their maternal diet during this very early period affect the genome-wide methylation status of the gametes of the male offspring. That was also easier to sample later on without sacrificing the animals. So we have a control under nutrition, and then we thought, you know, okay, under nutrition, but we target with the folic acid supplementation, a process that we know is very, very highly affects methylation, like deprivation of folic acid. So again, we applied RRBS, and we identify differentially methylated region, again using EGR, in offsprings that experience the different different conditions. And here you see results of this distribution. So as a conclusion of this very quick representation of our work in the last few years, we're still, you know, very appalled by the fact that there is still so much to do. And compared to genome, or working with the whole methylome is not as efficient, as you really have to go into the single process of methylation and demethylation, and as well with non-coding RNA, analyzing specific control of expression really at the gene level. But for sure, analyzing epigenetic variation will contribute largely to disentangle the phenotypic variants that we observe of the traits that are of economic interest in livestock. And here again, I highlight that reproduction is definitely always a very important process. Again, like one major difficulty that we have found is that, of course, whenever we look at difference in methylation, we need to weigh that with the net of differences at the genomic level. We are currently working in analyzing whole genome methylation by comparing the two subspecies, Taurus and Indicus. And I mean, it's a little bit tricky to clean up differences that we observe in the methylation level in the same tissue with differences, of course, in the genomic level. So right, looking at those cytosines, which are then, you know, in the process changing to thymine, and it's a little bit difficult to assert where the variation comes from. So there's still quite a bit of work to do there. And But again, the study of epigenetic response to environmental stress is relevant when considering adaptation to climate change. So it's quite important to go into that direction, into really putting together information that we have on important regions at the genome level, which respond to adaptation, to selection for adaptation, and how the process, how the epigenetic process influence those changes and regulate them through regulation of expression. And finally, I would like to present you virtually some of the colleagues that are working, you know, we work as a group together with colleagues from University of Milan, University of Napoli, and and colleagues participating to the other project, as for Professor Benjelou participating to this PRIMA project that is focusing on these kind of aspects. So here we have Flavia Pizzi, which is responsible for the reproduction area, and she is the manager of the gene bank. Barbara Lazzari and Paolo Cossi that work with me in the bioinformatic groups. And we again like try to put together these pre-compiled software, which are always very useful, but with some in-house coding that try to fix some of the inconsistency that we find in analyzing specifically our genomes, that, you know, sometimes both for lacking quality, sometimes for the peculiarity of the genome itself requires some work on it. And here, Emanuele Capra. Emanuele is really the driver of all these studies in the lab, as he is amazing in finding solution in molecular genetics protocols to obtain what he wants from the sequencing process. So he is dealing with all the bisulfite treatment protocols and with reduced representation and the preparation of libraries for sequencing. And Federica Turri, she again works with Flavia in reproduction, and again, like, she's an expert in semen quality and the use of the equipment to define the motility of the sperm and other characteristics of the semen. And with that, I would like to thank you for your attention and take your questions.
Thank you. Thank you, dear Alessandra, for this rich talk, which showed that many information first for about this field, about epigenetics in general, and also that showed us the great work you have done in during this last period in this field. I know it's not easy to work in such fields because you have to do many setting ups, and so it's not easy. Generally, it's not easy, and hope you will be ready for, we will be ready to work on, to work with these techniques within Scala Media project.
Right, right. Yeah, I have to say that, you know, is for people that don't know, this project is a very challenging project because it's taking these techniques to a higher level, because here, you know, so far we've been working in comparing mainly tissues and condition, but within the sperm cell, which, you know, is already more like limited in the difference that we can observe. But we're taking that to a higher level by comparing different conditions with, of course, many environmental and genomic factors, genomic variants and differences. So again, we will have to be able to screen all those differences to get to specific process within specific gene pathways.
Yes, definitely. So, but we have to advance in this field because we need to know more about mechanisms shaping the distribution of genetic diversity in different species. So, and this is an important component in this pool of omics information that shape the distribution of genetic diversity.
Yeah. So,
while waiting for questions from the audience, I have a question, a general question, in fact. Given this experience, given your experience in goat and cattle, how far we are from including this technique in the breeding programs? Because this is the...
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. What has been done, you know, when we have considered this epigenetic modification, when every time the genotype by environment interaction has been included in the process of genetic / genomic evaluation. But as you know, this has not been very successful. And I think it is because, of course, it's a little bit recurrent. I will go back just a second to my figure here. Of course, you know, the environment here comes in different... Sorry, I don't know how to go back quicker, so it would be like that. As I showed in this picture, especially, you know, when the phenotypes is, first of all, affected directly by the environmental factors and by the epigenetic filter, it's very difficult in genetic evaluation or genomic evaluation to dissect these two processes. So what I think is that we could be possibly applying this information on specific and very relevant, so with a major impact epigenetic change, modification as a new phenotype. So consider, especially, you know, if we could get something from blood very easily accessible, we may be able to consider these as a new phenotypes and perform data integration to predict the effect on the following generation on selected these individual and analyze their diversity by using the, for example, the methylation status specific gene as a new phenotype. Now, this is a little bit, you know, new and probably, you know, I'm just provocation here to say, but it could be, you know, with now the very powerful tool, informatic tool of data integration by using machine learning, this probably could be used as a predictor together with, you know, the traditional genomic information and the many other phenotypic information to better predict performance both of the animal and the progeny. So yes. This is the way I see, because otherwise in the immediate, I don't see, you know, other than, of course, which is very, again, very important, going deeply in the understanding of the physiological process and the biological process, as is very region specific, gene specific, and process specific, I don't see how it could be incorporated in the selection process as is now.
Because there is also the concern of the cost of the lab work and also bioinformatics, which is higher than classical genomic typing and so on.
Definitely.
And even we would like to...
And time consuming. Yes, yes. That's why, you know, it's probably, you need to simplify to get to those epigenetic, I would call it markers, you know, that really will catch and explain a larger part of the variance that is observing the phenotype, and find, you know, ways to synthesize that. I like to summarize that in information that can then be incorporated by also possibly maybe selectively characterizing, analyzing specific individuals in the population. So but you never know. I mean, I see it hard now to use it as a screening process for large numbers in the population.
Hope the technology will allow such manipulations.
That's true. I mean, if I were thinking of even like genotyping with high numbers in 20 years back, you know, we would have never thought that would be possible.
Yes, so, for sure.
Yeah.
So I have also another question, because during the presentation you said that the amount of methylation, it's not necessarily linked to this gene suppression.
And
we know that this technique, LUMA technique, which type methylation, it's based on the amount of methylation generally.
Yeah. So
what do you think about this?
Again, you know what? This could be like when our colleagues from INRAE presented the LUMA technology, we were analyzing this data and I was like, how? I don't understand how this can work. But again, don't think, you know, at a specific regulation of expression at this specific gene. Think it as a new phenotype. This, you know, the amount of methylation is a new phenotype. Let's see, and it would be interesting at a quantitative level with large numbers. Remember that, you know, here we're always looking at 3-4, you see, you know, the numbers of the study I presented, 3-5 animals. To the most, you know, animals. But with LUMA, we'll be able to process a large amount of large numbers, right? And there is probably, we're going to exert some correlation. There are not probably along the genome, but there are general information that we could more easily probably correlate and integrate with the other phenotypes and with genomic information, with general genomic information, such as, you know, the amount of variation, rather than going into, you know, compare it with general level of expression in individual or in a tissue. That's really, as we see regulation works, does not make very much sense.
Perfect. What about plants? Just to touch.
Yeah, yeah. You probably remember the presentation by our colleague. We collaborate a lot, Luigi Cattivelli, and we are analyzing some of the particularly microRNA in the wheat project, and there again, regulation expression is huge, as are the problems in analyzing this genome that is a very complicated genome, as you learn probably that day. But again, we haven't got into much of the methylation work because it's more complicated. I have a feeling that it plays a relatively less important role than in mammals, as is indicated generally. But we are pretty much ready to apply some of the specific study now that we are getting also the large effort in RNA-seq for wheat, for durum wheat.
Perfect. Because for insects, I can imagine that, like for bees, we know that methylation play a key role in even in the reproduction of the...
Yes, yes. One thing maybe I forgot to mention is also the role of some of the enzyme in demethylation, therefore in reprogramming, epigenetic reprogramming, which in bees plays a very important role. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, no, of course, and we're starting to see on specific gene again the important role in response to viruses and other disease. That again, and that the reprogramming and the demethylation is quite important in a process for activation.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Alessandra, for your rich answers. That was as rich as your talk.
Yeah, sorry, I probably went a little bit too long.
No, but it was interesting, really.
Okay.
But now we arrive to the end of the webinar because the time flies
always. Yeah, to run. And I would like, I will type here in the call my email.
Perfect.
And if a question come up for myself or colleagues, please send us an email and we'll get in touch with you. We're always open to collaboration and we usually, keep some funding for pet project that we like to to perform, and so we'll be glad if there are some ideas there for collaboration.
Yes, definitely. So thank you, Alessandra. At the end, I would like to mention that we will have a break during the end of this year. So the next webinar is scheduled in 4 weeks, not 2 weeks. My colleague Boutaina is going to share with us the flyer. So, perfect. Thank you, Boutaina. So, okay. The webinar will be entitled "The Management of Diversity in Local Chicken Breeds" and will be presented by Dr. Michel Tixier-Boichard, senior scientist at INRAE France, with Alessandra also in many projects. And we look forward to have this webinar, but it will be done in 2022, in 4 weeks, in the 6th of January, 2022. Otherwise, I would like to mention that when leaving the webinar session, you will get a very short, actually 3 questions survey to get your assessment of this webinar series. Please fill it. It will be very helpful. Finally, on behalf of the organizers, I would like to thank everyone who participated today and thank our guest speaker, Dr. Alessandra Stella, for her rich talk and rich answers. I would like to thank also my colleagues Boutaina Abidou, Othman Sabata, Reddat Tirazi, and Abdelaziz Yasri for their crucial contribution for organizing this webinar series. Alessandra, do you want to add something?
No, I again like to thank you and the whole audience. And it was very nice to be here today. And looking forward to hear from you and for, again, as I said, further collaboration. Thanks. Yes. Again.
Thank you. So see you in 4 weeks in 2022. Have a nice end of the year. Bye-bye. Ciao.